In the metabolism unit, we've seen a lot of different types of reactions. One is familiar, the condensation reaction, which we've seen in the context of glycosidic bonds and peptide bonds. In this tutorial, we'll review the condensation reaction and discuss the other major classes of reactions seen in metabolism: hydrolysis, phosphorylation and dephosphorylation, isomerization, and decarboxylation. Redox reactions are also central to metabolism, and they're covered in the redox reactions in metabolism tutorial. A condensation reaction joins two molecules with the loss of a small molecule. Most condensation reactions covered in this class involve the loss of water. This type of condensation reaction, in which water is lost, is a dehydration reaction. Condensation reactions are involved in the synthesis of the four major classes of biological molecules: nucleic acids, proteins, carbohydrates, and lipids. Condensation reactions join nitrogenous bases to ribose or deoxyribose sugars to form glycosidic bonds. A glycosidic bond is a bond between a sugar, in this case ribose, and another molecule, in this case uracil. This condensation reaction, and the other ones we'll see in this tutorial, involves the loss of water, so it's a dehydration reaction. Condensation reactions also join amino acids to form peptide bonds in proteins. In carbohydrates, condensation reactions join glucose molecules to create glycogen, the storage form of glucose. Glycogen is made up of long chains of glucose that have been joined by condensation reactions involving the loss of water to form glycosidic bonds. Like we saw in nucleic acids, the bonds connecting glucose molecules are glycosidic bonds because they connect a sugar to another molecule, in this case to another sugar molecule. Condensation reactions also join monosaccharides to create disaccharides. For example, these reactions join galactose with glucose to form lactose. In lipids, condensation reactions join glycerol with free fatty acids to create triacylglycerol, also called triglycerides. Condensation reactions are also involved in ATP synthesis. The enzyme ATP synthase catalyzes a condensation reaction that joins inorganic phosphate with ADP, forming ATP. This creates a phosphoanhydride bond between phosphate groups. Remember that this bond is considered to be a high-energy bond because it stores potential energy, so this condensation reaction is non-spontaneous and has a positive delta G. The delta G of the reverse reaction, the hydrolysis of ATP into ADP and inorganic phosphate, is very negative. This brings us to the hydrolysis reaction. The word hydrolysis comes from hydro, for water, and lysis, which means to break. A hydrolysis reaction is one that breaks a molecule of water into H+ and OH-, and at the same time breaks another molecule into smaller pieces. Hydrolysis reactions are the reverse of dehydration reactions, that specific category of condensation reaction where water is lost, because here, water is added to break another molecule. We've seen hydrolysis reactions in a variety of places. For example, the splitting of ATP into inorganic phosphate and ADP is a hydrolysis reaction. Water was broken into OH and H, and at the same time ATP was broken into inorganic phosphate and ADP. This reaction breaks a high-energy phosphoanhydride bond, releasing a lot of energy that can be harnessed to do cellular work. Hydrolysis reactions are also involved in the breakdown of the four major classes of biological molecules. After mRNA has been used as a template to create a polypeptide, glycosidic bonds are broken via hydrolysis reactions into the backbone and nitrogenous bases that can then be reused. Malformed polypeptides, or those that are tagged with ubiquitin for degradation, or muscle proteins that in an emergency must be used for fuel, are broken down via hydrolysis reactions into amino acids. Glycogen is broken down through hydrolysis reactions to release glucose that can be used in glycolysis. At the intestinal brush border cells, disaccharides are broken down via hydrolysis into monosaccharides that can be absorbed. Finally, triglycerides are broken down via hydrolysis into free fatty acids and glycerol. Phosphorylation reactions are those that add a phosphate group to a molecule. Phosphate groups are most commonly added onto oxygen atoms in a molecule. Phosphorylation is often used to store energy, such as in ATP, because covalent bonds to phosphate groups are often high-energy bonds. It's also used as a signal for cell processes. In addition, phosphorylation makes molecules more hydrophilic. In glycolysis, phosphorylation reactions occur at a variety of steps. For example, the first step of glycolysis is the phosphorylation of glucose at carbon 6, forming glucose 6-phosphate. The phosphate group comes from ATP. While the phosphorylation of glucose is a non-spontaneous process, the hydrolysis of ATP is spontaneous. With the help of hexokinase, these two processes are coupled, and the overall coupled reaction is spontaneous. Many cell proteins are phosphorylated during cell signaling. While this isn't something we've seen in the context of metabolism, it is an example of phosphorylation. For example, think about receptor tyrosine kinases, or RTKs. These large transmembrane proteins have particular amino acids in the chain that can be phosphorylated. Each RTK has a tyrosine side chain exposed to the intracellular cytoplasm that can be phosphorylated. I've only drawn the tyrosine on one RTK, but it exists on both. When a ligand binds to the RTKs, it brings the two closer together, forming a dimer. The dimerized receptors can phosphorylate these tyrosine amino acids. ATP is hydrolyzed to provide the phosphate groups that are added onto tyrosine. Dephosphorylation is the removal of a phosphate group from a molecule. For example, here's what the dephosphorylation of an RTK would look like. As water is broken, the bond between phosphate and tyrosine is also broken, releasing inorganic phosphate. Dephosphorylation does not necessarily mean synthesis of ATP. Only in certain circumstances, such as substrate-level phosphorylation in glycolysis, can a phosphate group be removed from one molecule and immediately added to ADP to form ATP. Because the covalent bond between ADP and inorganic phosphate stores so much energy, the delta G of the formation of ATP is very positive, so a lot of energy input is required for this reaction to occur. Isomerization reactions are those that change the arrangement of atoms in a molecule without adding or taking away any. These reactions simply change how atoms are connected to each other. The second step of glycolysis is an isomerization reaction, which rearranges glucose 6-phosphate to form fructose 6-phosphate. Here, I've labeled the carbons from 1 to 6 in each molecule. Carbon 1 in glucose 6-phosphate is the same atom as carbon 1 in fructose 6-phosphate. In this isomerization reaction, this bond shown in orange is broken, and this bond shown in orange is made. Finally, a decarboxylation reaction is one in which a carbon atom and two oxygen atoms are lost from a molecule as carbon dioxide. This reaction is seen during the citric acid cycle, as carbon atoms are oxidized. This generates the carbon dioxide that we breathe out. For example, one step in the citric acid cycle is the transformation of isocitrate into alpha-ketoglutarate. This carbon and these two oxygens from isocitrate are broken off and released as carbon dioxide. Isocitrate is oxidized into carbon dioxide and alpha-ketoglutarate. Oxidation reactions are always coupled with reduction reactions. Here, NAD+ is reduced to NADH. These reaction types are commonly seen in metabolism. In order to occur under normal cell conditions, they generally require an enzyme. The reaction types we focus on most are condensation and hydrolysis, and phosphorylation and dephosphorylation.